Risabarotoros. For a second, I told you in a Spanish church, girls, you did an excellent job. Thank you for your beautiful rendition. You know, when I was asked to do this sermon, I said yes immediately because throughout my life I have looked at pastors and thought to myself, you know, preaching is an easy thing. You just get some scriptures from the Bible and put them together in the beginning. Blessed are they that keep his commandments. And you know, you just do it with a little enthusiasm. But as I sat down, I noticed it was a little more difficult than I thought. But to God be the glory, great things he has done. I am here this morning. Before I begin, I would like to welcome my family. My mom is here. I think you all need to put me to preach every week so we could see her more often. Also, my aunts, June, Juliet, and my uncle-in-law, and Kimora. I know many of you all would have known Kimora when she's a little baby. She used to come with me. A very special welcome to you all, and I'm happy to have you here. So to begin, we will turn to Acts chapter 1. Acts chapter 1 and then John chapter 4. And because of time, I would read in your hearing. So Acts chapter 1. I forget where the books are. So Acts chapter 1. Acts chapter 1 verse 8. And it says, "But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be a witness unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the utmost part of the earth." And then we go to John chapter 4 verses 7, 9 and then 27 to 29. And it reads, "There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus saith unto her, Give me to drink. Then said the woman of Samaria unto him, How is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. Verse 27. And upon this came his disciples and marveled that he talked with the woman. Yet no man said, What seekest thou? Or why talkest thou with her? The woman then left her water pot and went away into the city and said to the men, Come see a man. Is not this the Christ? Come see a man which told me all things that ever I did." I was so excited to come see this man. "Which told me all things that ever I did. Is this not the Christ?" This morning, our sermon, in line with the women's ministry team, is titled, and I think I gave away my first page, "The Devil is Busy." Okay, I found it. It was lost, but now it's found. Lord. In line with the woman's ministry team, our topic for today is titled, "That's What We're Here For." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we get into your word, I pray that your Holy Spirit will come nigh. Take hold there, Lord Jesus. Don't let me speak, but you speak through me there, Lord. And I pray that in the end, some heart will be blessed and some life will be transformed. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So as I read those words, "Is this not the Christ? Is not this the Christ?" it brought me back to an experience that I had last Sabbath. And that experience last Sabbath brought me back to an experience that I had some years ago. So I'll begin with the one some years ago. There was this young lady. Both of us, we went to primary school together. And in the early days, we were very close friends. In first year, second year, you know, when we just began writing letters, we would write letters and place in each other mails box and stuff. But then we went on, as we got older, our interests and our personalities differed. So we were still friends, but not as close. We then went on from primary school to the same secondary school, different classes, again, casual friends. And then, before we could even dream of graduating from secondary school, she dropped out. So, afterwards, I graduated. And you know the usual, when you graduate from school and you see your classmates on the street, you'll be like, hey, girl, you didn't see Jamaica is a police officer now, and John is a fireman, and I hear Michael studying to be a doctor. But they would always then bring up this young lady. We'll call her name Jill. And they would say, but you ain't see Jill? Jill good for nothing, you know. She have children, we wearing short pants. She have piercings all over, always drinking, always smoking. And I would feel bad because everybody who I come into contact with, they'll be like, you remember Jill? You ain't see Jill say this girl have no hope. Nevertheless, I remember sitting in class one day. I was at USC. And I felt like the Holy Spirit convicted me to go and visit Jill. I was like, Lord, I don't have time for that. My course load heavy. So I ignored it. Then I heard the Holy Spirit tell me again, go visit Jill. Long story short, I ended up going and visit Jill. When I went to Jill's home, she was so happy. She was excited and she just started sharing a lot of stories. And I said to myself, you know what? This girl need a friend. And I made up my mind to go and visit her once a week, every week. And at the time, she was pregnant. And when I would go, I would carry fruits and drinks and, you know, snacks for her little sibling. And then one day, after doing it for a couple of weeks, maybe months, Jill looked at me. She said, you're a Christian. And I was like, yes. She said, the God you're serving has to be the true God. She said, you're so different. Then last week, we were driving, long story short, I give a guy a bad drive. And you know, typical Trini drivers, once they get him a bad drive, you know you're gonna get it good. So he started. And when while he was in his rantings, then I looked at him, I gave my brightest smile. And I put on my most sincere voice, and I was like, my humble apologies. And the driver immediately hushed. But the guy in the back seat, he began talking. He said, you look like a Christian. You look like Jesus. Do you have a church? I will follow you to church. And you know, he shouted out his number and we wrote it down. And you know, in the moment, we laughed about it, all the girls and I. But then in my quiet moments, I began to reflect on these two encounters. And as I meditated upon the words of the Samaritan woman, is not this the Christ? I began to consider. The Samaritan woman was living a life of open sin. She passed through 5 husbands, and the man she was entertaining at that point of time was not her husband. She wasn't a Jew or a Seventh-day Adventist. Likewise, my friend was living with a man who had repeatedly abused her. She was a victim of rape. She became promiscuous at a young age. She drank alcohol, she smoked, she used obscene language. She was a school dropout, and she had absolutely no religious background. Then there was the backseat passenger. He looked disheveled. It seemed like he was just returning from a hard day of work on the Lord's Sabbath. His appearance and manner of speech did not suggest that he was a Christian. Nonetheless, what this Samaritan woman, what my school friend and the backseat passenger had in common was an understanding of who or what Christ should look like. From these experiences, it tells me that the world seems to have an innate ability of what constitutes a Christian. Are we faithfully representing? A little background on the story of Jesus and the Samaritan woman. So Jesus and the Jews had just traveled from Judea, and they were hungry. And Jesus was extremely tired and thirsty. And he said, you know what? Boys, you go get the food. You go buy the food. And I would sit down here by the well and hope that somebody stops by to get water and ask them for drink to quench my thirst and, you know, to muster up some strength. And while waiting, somebody definitely came, the Samaritan woman. And Jesus asked her, could you give me some of your water, please? And she stood back. Well, I don't know if she stood back, but she was in awe. She was like, you, a Jew, talking to me, a Samaritan? And Jesus, he began to break down barriers, and then he offered her the gift of salvation in the form of living water. He convicted her of her sins. He said, go call your husband. She said, I don't have none. He said, that's right. You had five, and now you're living with one who is not yours. But however, in it, he gave her a message of hope. And she received the message with gladness, and she ran to bring others to hear of that message. The disciples now, upon their return with food, begged Jesus to eat. But he was absorbed as wrapped in meditation. He was ever on a high end. It was like just excitement. His face was beaming with light, and they feared to interrupt his communion with heaven. In discerning their concern, Jesus then looked at the disciples and said, I have meat to eat that you know not of. Then he continued, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to accomplish his work. Amen. Reflecting on the encounter and how the Samaritan woman instantly accepted the light, Jesus rejoiced within his heart. He saw one saved for eternity, drinking of the water of life, and his own hunger and thirst was satisfied. He was no longer hungry. The accomplishment of the mission which he had left heaven to perform strengthened the Savior for his labor and lifted him above the necessities of humanity. And I am sure that in his moment, in his sense of accomplishment, Christ was able to look at his disciples and say, boys, that's what we're here for. You know, there are many of us Christians who go through life without any true joy, any satisfaction. We have the best jobs, the highest degree, food on our table, shoes on our feet, great friends, loving families, and yet there's an emptiness within our hearts. You ever wondered why? Maybe it is because we aren't doing the will of him that sent us. Looking back, before I go to that, I would have to admit there were periods I in my life too, even as a Christian, had very low moments. I didn't have no joy in my heart. And one such time was when I was abroad at school. You know, I was so focused. I had two jobs. And I was so focused on making my hours so I could pay my bills. And my graduate program was very demanding. And I was just so focused on getting good grades. And those who would have been talking with me frequently know that most of my time I used to be depressed and sad and just there in my room. And then the good thing about being at an Adventist university is there's usually plenty opportunities for mission. So one day my colleagues and I, we went out. And when I came back to my suite, I was all happy and bubbly, what many of you all know me to have originally been. And my seatmates were like, Chica, what's going on with you today? You drink or something? How are you so excited? And I felt bad because I know that's the person that I am. But then I began to think, I was doing the will. It's God's will for us to serve. You know, looking back at the experience with my... Looking back at the experience with my friend and the backseat passenger, who was able to see Christ in me, bestowed upon me that same sense of purpose. That aha moment where I was able to say, but wait, that's what we as Christians are here for. My friends, my simple duty in standing here today is to remind us that our very essence, our ultimate purpose as Christians, is to witness of Christ. to every single human being that we come into contact with. Not just when we go out in the next 2 weeks to distribute bread and say, "Woo, I witnessed today, I'm feeling good." No, our very lifestyle is supposed to be one that is witnessing. When the Samaritan woman told Jesus that Christ is to come and he will tell them of all things, in confidence, Christ was able to say, "I am he." And by no means she doubted or had a reason to. Can we with the same confidence face our family, our friends, our co-workers, storekeepers, neighbors, and strangers and say that we are Christians? Can these people run with the same confidence and say, "Come see a woman, come see a man, he or she is definitely a Christian"? Can they? One day, a minister asked a businessman if he were a Christian. "No, I cannot say I am. Still, I do not know, but I am as good as most church members." For instance, yesterday I got on board the train to ride into Chicago. They came in the coach and sat beside me a woman who I know very well and who is a prominent church worker. She claims to be a Christian and knows that I am not a Christian. But in all the three-hour ride, she did not do another blessed thing but gossip and tell tales about her friends and neighbors. Until when the train stopped in the city, I was heartily glad to get away from her. Now, why did that woman who professed to be a follower of Christ spend all her time in gossip and had nothing to say about her master? Yes, why do we as Christians say so little about our master? And why do our lives so often deny him? It is a sad fact that thousands of Christians are content to live on a low plane, showing no desire to grow up in the full stature of Christ, and having no ambition to live the life of a faithful witness. I have some questions to ask you all this morning. What is more important, getting married or staying married? Stay married or getting married? The big wedding, they look nice. What about experiencing childbirth or parenting? Getting hired or staying hired? Staying hired. So many of you all answered correctly. The truth be told is, there's more to being married than getting married. There's more to children than just giving birth to them. There's more to being employed than just getting hired. So too, there's more to being a Christian than just getting converted and attending church. There's more that God wants to do with us and through us. Nonetheless, some of us are quick to justify our low standard Christian living by quoting scripture and saying we are born in sin and shapen in iniquity. Or, "Kill the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." Indeed, we are born in sin and sure enough the spirit is willing, waiting, and desiring to abide in us. In fact, Christ before his ascension informed the disciples of their life work. In presenting to them their duty, he did not leave them without provision for the execution of the work. Christ said, "But ye shall receive power after the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses." We have this promise, but then why am I still living as a sinful, low-plane Christian, you may ask? Let's take a look at the disciples of old. After Jesus ascended, the disciples waited for the fulfillment of the promise. As they awaited, they humbled their hearts in true repentance and confessed their unbeliefs. They meditated upon the pure and holy life of Christ. They reminisced upon his lovely character. They came close together in Christian fellowship. Their days of preparation for the Holy Spirit were days of deep heart searching. These disciples felt their spiritual need and cried to the Lord for the holy unction that was fit to them, fit for them to do the work of being a true witness. And sure enough, they received the promise. Today, if you desire to engage in our life work and faithfully represent Christ, we need to do like the disciples of old and engage in earnest prayer and supplication. We need to totally surrender to Christ with repentant hearts. We need to cry out to God and say, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." We need to commune with Christ daily through his word and learn of him. Then the old sinful man or woman will begin to drop off. We will die to flesh and will become new creatures in Christ. The Holy Spirit will abide and then will be manifest the fruit of the Spirit, which is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. As we live in the Spirit, we begin to walk in the Spirit, and we will then reflect the irresistible loveliness of the character of Christ. And as Christ is lifted up, all men would be drawn to him. So we see Christ, he gave the commission, which was, go be a witness. Then he made the provision, which is his Holy Spirit. But now it's up to us to do what needs to be done so that we may be able to live as extraordinary Christians. Bringing it home to us now, giving it some context, I would like to suggest that in this room today, in the confines of this sanctuary, we have three classes of Christians. The first one is the false witness. As Seventh-day Adventists, we take pride in the fact that we are 100% commandment keepers. If you love me, keep my commandments. We keep the fourth commandments, while many other Christian denominations do not keep that commandment, which says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. But think for a moment. Are many of us really keeping all 10? Look at the 9th commandment. It says, thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. Are we bearing false witness against the one who is near us, who has promised that he will never leave us nor forsake us, that he will be with us even unto the end of the world? Sure enough, some of us have been false witnesses. How? By the way we dress, the conversations we carry on, the places we go, the entertainment we choose, our behavioral conduct, our language, the things we eat, the things we drink, and the many other pleasures and vanities we indulge in. In the spirit of prophecy, it is said, every man's work passes in review before God and is registered for faithfulness or unfaithfulness. Opposite each name in the books of heaven is entered with terrible exactness, every wrong word. So Toshika Makoy, on the 9th of March, 2010, cursed her neighbor. Every secret sin, with every artful dissembling, heaven sent warnings of reproofs neglected, wasted moments I'm guilty on Facebook and WhatsApp holy. Unimproved opportunities, the influence exerted for good or for evil, with its far-reaching results, all chronicled, all written by the recording angel. Great Controversy, page 481. You hear that? Not only does the angels take note of what we did wrong, or what we failed to do, or what we said, but its far-reaching results. So Toshika Makoy on March 9, 2010, cursed her neighbor Susan. And as a result, Susan said, you see me and them Christian people? Them just like me. I am not going to no Christian church. No. And as a result, Susan, she lose her soul salvation, all because of Toshika. But to the false witnesses, be it known, Because of your unfaithfulness as professed Christians, you have led many to denounce the Christian faith. And now their souls have been destined for hell's fire. The stain of their blood is upon your shoulder. However, there is good news for us this morning. Amen. Hallelujah. As the word neighbor in and of itself is defined, the one who showed mercy, our neighbor Jesus himself is merciful. And once you confess your sins of false witnessing, he is faithful and just to forgive you. In this forgiveness, you can go forth in the newness of life and be a faithful witness. So the first, we had the false witness. The second is the standstill witness, and I'll drink some water for that. The second is the standstill witness. So there are some Christians who apparently do nothing. Nothing you can positively condemn. Nothing which merits condemnation. They are like a savings bank in New York that was closed by order of the state examiner, Caleb Cobweb. And he says of it, the institution was entirely sound. There was no lack of confidence in its officers. The bank had been paying dividends regularly. Why then was it closed? Because it had not been growing. It had been merely standing still. The bank failed, and so will every Christian who is content to live as a standstill witness. It is a very dangerous thing to be satisfied, to stand still, to be content merely to do nothing wrong. To stand still in one's Christian experience means to become petrified in sin. The sin of omission, that sin of failure to do that which God has commissioned us to do. If you are a standstill witness, to you I say, every true disciple is born into the kingdom of God not to stand still, but to go forth as true witnesses. Being a Christian does not stop with theoretical faith. I know about Jesus. I know from Genesis to Revelation. It requires practical faith in Christ. He who drinks of the living water becomes a fountain of life. The receiver becomes a giver. Do like the Samaritan woman. Run at once and carry the light of Christ to all. For it is said in Proverbs 11:30, the fruit of the righteous is a tree of life, and he that winneth souls is wise. I know many times some of us could be a standstill Christian only because we do not understand our gifts. And once we understand our spiritual gifts, we could use it as opportunities to get in and to reach the people. I've learned that one of my dominating spiritual gifts is voluntary poverty. I say something, I just look poor. It basically means that I could renounce material comfort and luxury in order to reach those of a poor class, whereby they could feel respected and have some form of dignity. So when I went to Madagascar in 2017, and as you would have known, it was the fifth or sixth poorest country in the world. We were doing a lot of rural community visits. But before that, my colleagues were there with me for 1 month. And when we in the bus going different places, I'd be like, holy, I wish this bus could shut down so we could experience living in the village. And they used to be like, girl, you mad, don't say those things. There is power in the tongue. But then, when they left and I was there alone, guess what happened? The van shut down. And it was night. Madagascar, probably 90% of the country do not have electricity. So the guys were there trying to get the vehicle out, and they tried and tried. Night fell upon us, so about 2 hours in the dark, they were still trying. Then one of the guys in the community came, talked to my boss. He said, you all come to my house. When I heard that, my boss came back and translated, I was happy. But my boss and they were embarrassed because this visitor, this stranger with us, and we have to put her under these circumstances. But in my head, it was like heaven came down and glory filled this place. So when we were going down, trekking down the hill to go to his little hut, the wife ran outside. She lit a fire, she made omelette, and she boiled some rice. It was the best food I've ever tasted. And then we sat there on the ground inside, and we began eating, and they apologizing. And they were all feeling bad, and I was like, I communicated with translators, and I said, no, tell them I've been praying for this. I'm so happy to be here to experience what it is to live like you all live. And I was honestly elated. And the man of the home, immediately he got his face lit up. He said, you just came from America where you have food, you have a toilet, you have a bed. They had none of those things, and you're happy? He said, come to my church on Sunday and talk to the people. No, if my boss and they were willing to go out, but they didn't want to risk the chance of getting stuck, I may have gotten the opportunity to use my spiritual gift and go and convert a whole church. So people, use your gift. Some of you all have the gift of help. You may see somebody struggling, walking with a bag. Help them. It could open opportunities for conversation. Then some of you all have the gift of giving. Tracy, yesterday, Annie Maxie struggling for money, and she gave me money. I get reconverted. So use your gifts. Use your gifts. So far we had the false witness. We had the... And the third and final is the faithful witness. The one who is striving. And I know there are many of us in here who are genuinely striving. It says, throughout the Bible, a witness affirms that he or she has seen or heard something or have been taught something through divine revelation or inspiration. So I had my personal experience with Christ. And now I'm going to share it, whether it's by the way I live or the things I tell others. But in this particular verse, Acts chapter 1, verse 8, in Greek translation, it is called martyrs, which by analogy is a martyr. So the definition extends to say, a witness is those who by their example have proved the strength and genuineness of their faith in Christ by undergoing a violent death. So this faithful witness is determined to do whatever is necessary by the grace of God, not only to endure the challenges that come with the work of the witness, but also to suffer it with joy. The faithful witness makes every effort to bear a true Christian standard in the face of fiery ordeals. As Christians, we would have challenging times, you know, but you're still staying true to your standard. They are hated, they are rejected, they are condemned, they are scorned, they are frowned upon, scoffed at, and there's great determination on the enemy's part to kill their spirit and their body. But to this faithful witness, there is no limit to their zeal. They are resolute in purpose, prompt in action, strong in faith, and they are committed to do the faithful work of winning souls to Jesus. They remain steadfast to the gospel, bearing faithful witness for Christ. If you are this faithful witness, to you I want to recount verses in Hebrews chapter 11 and 12. And it says, our fathers of old, through faith, wrought righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword. Out of weaknesses they were made strong, waxed valiant in fight, turned to flight the armies of aliens. They were tortured, Others had trial of cruel mockings and scourgings. Yea, moreover, the bonds of imprisonment. They were stoned. They were sawn asunder. They were tempted, were slain with sword. They wandered about in sheepskins and goatskin, being destitute, afflicted, tormented. They wandered in deserts and in mountains and in dens and in caves of the earth. But through it all, they obtained a good report. Wherefore, seeing you are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, you need to lay aside every weight that is compelling you to give up, and every sin which seeks to hinder you, you need to run with patience the race that is set before you. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of your faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross and despising the shame. So my dear faithful witnesses, when you go through the waters, God will be there with you. When you go through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned. Neither shall the flame kindle upon you. And even if God permits your flesh to be destroyed, on that great getting up morning, great will be your reward. In closing, the Samaritan woman asks, is this not the Christ? My school friend uttered, you're different. The backseat passenger exclaimed, you look like Jesus. And I, in agreement with Paul, say, and without controversy, hallelujah, great is the mystery of godliness or Christ-likeness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on the world, received up into glory. Brothers and sisters in Christ, this morning, I ask of you to pray earnestly to God to make you an extraordinary Christian. After all, that's what we're here for. The world is languishing for want of men and women who will live the life of extraordinary Christians, which is to say, faithful witnesses. Will you be such a one? God wishes to write in your heart his law of love and purity. He wants your life to be in this sinful world what the pure lily is in the dirty, stagnant pool. More than that, he wants you to help others regain their lost heritage. Does not your heart ache when you see women selling a useful, noble career for some fleeting pleasure? Are you not pained to see young men with bright prospects go galloping on to ruin? Then step in the breach. Be a Daniel. Be an Esther. Be an Esther. Where millions are perishing, we have no time to think of ease or selfish gratification. For your own sake, for the sake of others, and for the sake of Christ, live the life of a faithful witness. This morning I charge and I challenge every one of you to go forth in the light of Christ and let your light so shine that every single person you come into contact with, not just your family, not just your immediate friends, not just those in church, but every single person you come into contact with may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven.
Trouble of be done. Trouble everywhere. Going home to leave the gold. No more weeping on wailing, no more weeping on wailing, no more. Weeping on wailing, going home to live with my Lord. Soon we'll be done. Trouble all the world. Trouble of the world, trouble, Lord of this world. Soon we'll be done. Trouble. My love, I want see my mother. I want see. Trouble of the world, trouble of the world, trouble of this world. How soon will be done with the trouble.